Okay, good morning. So the title is The Design of the Interconnect for Effective Chip Multiprocessor Systems. So the talk will be focused on chip multiprocessor systems, and I will describe what is a chip multiprocessor system, and specifically on the design of an interconnect, an efficient interconnect for this kind of systems. So I think all of us agree that we are in the many core area, that many a lot of cores can be integrated in the same chip. Technology allows this. And this evolution is power-driven in the sense that it is far more efficient to include many cores that are power-efficient. There are simple cores rather than using a single high-performance core that is less power-efficient. Okay. The problem with this that I will not talk in this talk is the complexity that is moved to the memory hierarchy and to the programming, because we need to think in parallel. Okay. So let's see which are the typical components of a possible many-core chip. So in this talk, we aim for what is called a tile-based approach. We have different tiles, okay? All are the same, so let's think of an homogeneous system. And in every tile, we have this kind of components, simple cores in other processors, typically. We can have very long instruction word cores also, accelerators, memory modules, or IP components, okay? But the tile is the same design, okay? Why? Because the engineers are focused mostly on designing the tile, and then they only need to step and repeat. Okay, and this is easier to implement a chip in this way. Okay, it's more efficient. So we see that there is a complexity trend that is reducing. We are putting simple things, okay, but we are putting more components. So, and we need to connect them between them. So this is where it comes, the network on chip. The network on chip simply is a network inside a chip, okay? So the complexity of the network on chip tends to increase, but probably not because it becomes more complex, but because it becomes larger, okay? If we think of 100 cores, we need to connect 100 cores. That is more critical than connect simply 2 cores or 4 cores, okay? So as we increase the number of cores, the cores tend to be equal or simpler, but the network tends to be larger, okay? So it is expected to have an increased impact and possible bottleneck of the network on chip, the NOC concept, okay? Let's put a typical CMP, okay? A CMP will be 16 tiles in this case, and then in every tile we have possibly 4 cores, okay? 4 L1 caches that are private to the core. Then possibly we can have 4 banks of L2 cache, okay? That is private to the tile, okay? This is private memory. And here we have the first interconnect. That this is a crossbar. Could be a ring or a bus also, okay? So the aim of this network is to connect cores between L2, okay? And also we can have an L3. An L3 is shared among all the tiles, okay? So this is a unified view of the memory, okay? And then here we have complexity in the sense that we need what is called a directory. A directory just keeps which tiles have copies of the block that is allocated in L3, okay? In order to keep the coherence, okay? Because this is shared memory, okay? This L3. And then we have a second level of network, that is the router, and the router basically builds the interconnect for the chip, okay? We are focused on this one, okay? Because this is very simple, would be a crossbar, okay? And typically here, the router is connected to every tile, to the neighboring tile, sorry, and then we build a 2D mesh, okay? For topologies, the typical network that is in academia and in most prototypes for networks on chip is the 2D mesh. Okay, but there are other options. I will stay with a 2D mesh here. Okay. Why this tile-based design? Because if technology scales, then we can scale the system. We just put more tiles. Okay, assuming that the network is not the bottleneck, so we can scale, okay? But the engineers can also redesign the tile, maybe put in more cores or more memory or whatever, and then we also scale, okay? So this is an interesting approach, the tile-based design. In this talk, I will focus on tile-based design. So in that scenario, we have a network on chip. A network on chip is, as I said, a network inside a chip. So there is nothing new in the sense that a network is basically a topology, a routing, switching, flow control, and arbitration. This is the four pillars of a network, okay? Topology and routing are very close connected because the routing depends on the topology. The topology basically is the routes, and the routing is where packets can go, okay? Switching and flow control dictates advanced information, and arbitration resolves contention. This is well-known concepts that is just applying to a new environment. This is networks on chip, okay? But the thing is that in a network on chip, things are closer than in a typical off-chip network, okay? And then it means that we can design better the system in order to enhance the performance of the chip, okay? We can take advantage of the proximity of components. We don't need to think directly on just applying a network. We need to design the best network for the chip, okay? And then this comes to the coherence protocol. We need to design the coherence protocol and the network in isolation, or we need to co-design in order to improve, okay? So this is, if we have time, then I will briefly talk about this, okay? So here are the four pillars: switch design, the link, and the network interface, on top the topology, on top the routing, and then the coherence protocol, and switching and flow control here. Here, in the new environment, in networks on chip, we need to be power efficient, okay? And then this means that the routing has a lot to do with power, because if we can want to save power, we can switch off components, and then the routing needs to avoid those switch it off components, okay? Let's say that the routing is the smart component of a network. All the rest is static, okay? Obviously, we want ultra-fast network. Then the routing again. Depending on the path you take, you can have contention or avoid contention, and then you deliver faster packets, okay? So routing also affects this. Threats, process variations, alpha particles, and all these kind of things that can make your chip to fail. The routing also can play a vital role because you can avoid faulty components also by routing, okay? And this one that will be most of the presentation is what we call virtualization, that could be partitioning. If we think of 200 cores, do we have an application to exploit the 200 cores? Probably not. And then are we going to buy a 200 cores? Probably not. But in a data center that we have many requests requiring less than 200 cores, probably what we can do is to partition the chip and assign the different tasks or applications to different resources of the chip. So we need to partition so many cores into different clients, okay? This is what we call also virtualization, because one application gets the idea that is alone in the system, but is only partitioned, isolated from the rest. Okay, and this affects also routing, because you want to avoid traffic from one application to cross over the other partitions. So what we would like to have is to have this kind of system. This is 64 tiles with 256 cores, 4 in each, and then we have from the fab 2-3 tiles that are defective. Okay, we want them to be switched off, okay? And then we want also to route packets inside this. Also, we have 4 applications, and then we want to map the applications to the demanding number of resources. Here, this green one requires more resources, more processors, for instance. Okay? And also, the cores that are not used, we want to put them in sleep mode. We want to save power also. Okay? So this is what we would like to have. So let's aim in that direction. Try to have one chip with such properties, and we'll see that routing is enabling all these possibilities. Okay? Routing. Routing basically tells the packet where it has to cross, okay? In which paths. Is this important? This is very important because of the deadlock probability. In a typical network on chip, on a typical off-chip network for high-performance computing, you cannot discard any packet. Okay? In wireless, you can discard packets. And then routing becomes very simple. But in these kind of systems that are flow-controlled, it means that you will never send a packet to the next hop unless you have buffers, okay? Then you can have deadlock. And deadlock occurs when you have a cycle of packets requesting the next resources, okay? So routing is very important here because it needs to prevent deadlock, okay? Because if a deadlock occurs, the system collapses because the packets get not delivered and the application stacks, okay? So this is the main difference between wireless, for instance, and on-chip networks. These are flow-controlled and need to avoid, by design, the deadlock property. Okay? So, if I want to have this kind of partitions, then which is the current NOC trend in industry? 2D mesh topologies. Okay? 2D mesh, this is a 2D mesh, but we want to partition it. Finite state machine based routing, XY. XY is the very simplest routing algorithm. Basically, a packet goes in X direction and then follows in Y direction. This is deadlock free because there is no packet that goes in Y direction and then in X direction, so you don't close the cycle. Okay? This is very simple. Okay? Warhol switching, it means that packets can be larger than the buffer in the routers. Okay, in order to save area. Okay, and no virtual channel support. Virtual channel means that if you are in a highway, you have different lanes. Is the same. You have the different virtual channels, then you can bypass packets. Okay, but this is very expensive because you need buffers for every virtual channel. Okay, so if we have this baseline, we cannot support this kind of configurations. Okay, mostly. Because if I want to go from A to B for this partition, I need to cross the border of the partition. I'm affecting the other partition. Here the same, okay? And here the same, because I need to go X and then Y, okay? So the routing algorithm is not compatible with this kind of configurations. We need something else, okay? The straightforward solution is just tables. Tables is for every switch, or at every injector, we have a table, and for every destination, we just tell which path to follow. Okay? But the problem of this is the area, the delay, and the power of these kind of solutions, because the number of entries or tables grows quadratically with the system size. You require n tables with n entries for a system with n nodes, okay? So here you can see the difference between tables in area, in delay, and in power for XY routing. Okay? It's clear 20 times more power, 40 times more area, and 70% more delay. Okay? Also, XY routing, we would like to have broadcast. Broadcast is collective communication per partition, okay? And XY routing does not allow this also, okay? So, what we can propose, what we proposed in the past is what we call the logic-based distributed routing. It's like a methodology rather than an implementation, okay? Is to think in the following way. The first step, try to represent a routing algorithm in a compact way. Okay? Representation is independent of the network size. And we want to go for scalability. We don't want to use tables. Second step, once you represent a routing algorithm, is to encode the routing representation in a compact way, in as few bits as possible. We need bits at the end, okay, to configure a routing algorithm. And the third step is to implement this encoding in an efficient way, as few logic gates as possible. Okay? So, and this leads to LBDR. So the first step is the following one, that maybe is a bit complex, is here you see a topology, and the topology which has some components that are failed, okay, or in off mode, okay? This is not a 2D mesh anymore, okay? We cannot apply XY routing. But here, notice that we represent the routing algorithm that is up-down routing. I will not go into details. Up-down routing basically is a topology-agnostic routing algorithm, can be applied to any topology, okay? But we represent by these arrows, routing restrictions. Basically, a routing restriction tells you that you cannot cross this link in the east direction and then take in the north. You cannot. It's a restriction. You cannot, simply. And they are bidirectional. You cannot go south and then west. Okay? This is the simplest way, or the most compact way to represent the up-down routing. Notice that there is no deadlock. You cannot close a cycle without crossing a restriction. It's deadlock-free. Okay? And notice that you can connect every source with every destination. For instance, you can go to the root and then go. Okay? So, this is the first step, and then let's go for the second step. We have the routing represented in a compact way, and now we implement it in a compact way, or we encode it. Let's use, in every switch, two routing bits per output port, and these bits will be set to 0 or to 1 if the routing restriction is there or not. So basically, if this switch wants to send a packet in that direction, then this bit is set to 0 because it tells you that you cannot go east and then north. Okay? We are encoding the routing restrictions in bits in the previous hop. Okay? This is good because the number of bits will not grow with the network size in every switch. We always require 2 bits per output port per switch. Okay? And then this bit is set to 0 because of this restriction also. Okay? This is called routing restrictions. And then let's go to the connectivity, because we have a hole here, and here there is no link because it has failed. Then we need 1 bit per output port to tell us if there is connectivity or not. It's simple. Okay? So the encoding is the routing bits and the connectivity bit, 3 bits per output port. Okay? And then the third step is to implement the routing. It's logic-based distributed routing. It's based on logic. This is the logic for every output port. This is for the north output port. So it's 3 gates of AND gates, 2 inverters, 1 OR, and then 1 AND gate, okay? Connecting the connectivity bit. I can go to the north if I go to the north and I don't go to the east or west. I'm going that direction, okay? I'm not going to change direction. Or if I go to the north and east, and then at the north I can take east because there is no routing restriction, okay? Or northwest, okay? And I can turn to the west, okay? This is the logic of the XY routing. Basically, we compare the current switch and the destination switch to know the directions of the destination, okay? And then we just feed these signals to this logic. Here I have an example. From A to B, can I go north? Yes, because my destination is northeast, and I don't have routing restriction here. And the same here, I could take east, because here I have no routing restriction. It's safe to go that way. Here I have 2 options. The arbiter just selects one. Okay, we can take this one. But notice here that in this step, I cannot go north because my destination is northeast, and I have a routing restriction. Okay, it's forbidden. Okay. Then I go east. Okay? Notice that you always get a path, a valid path, to reach your destinations. Okay? Here the same. I cannot go north, then I take east, and then I take north. Okay? With this LBDR, obviously, notice that LBDR follows minimal path. We always go in profitable output ports. Okay? That get us closer to the destination. Of course, if you have a hole here, you need to do non-minimal path, okay? And of course, if you have here a failed link and a failed link, you have two branches, then these two nodes are in the same quadrant, and then for one you need to take north, and for one you need to take west. Okay? So there are special cases that are not covered. So what we did is to put two additional logics to LBDR. When LBDR fails, then we have the deroute option. Deroute means go east. Don't ask me, but don't go east, because I know that you will reach destination. Okay? They are pre-compute, these bits. Okay? You need 2 bits per port. And for this case, you do the fork. The fork basically is a packet is replicated and will reach destination, and the other will be eliminated. Okay? Because this is a stale copy. Okay? So this completes the LBDR approach. Okay? What we get with this is this. Coverage. XY routing, coverage 0. Does not support any failure. Okay? LBDR, the basic LBDR, 22%. This is bad, because non-minimal paths are not supported. But when we add the routes and forks, we attain 100% coverage. This means that all the configurations with failures from a 2D mesh are supported. Okay? And which is the cost? This is the routing engine. The area is practically the same of XY routing. So we have the complexity of XY routing. Okay? And which is the delay? The delay is almost 20% more than the one from XY routing. This is bad. But if you put this logic into a pipeline switch, you see no difference in area and delay. Why? Because the most complex element in a switch is the arbiter. So the routing has a lot of slack in the cycle. Okay? So we can fit this logic in the time of the arbiter. Okay? So what we got? We got the flexibility of tables without using tables. Okay? With implementation of XY routing. Okay? So what we can go for? We can go for virtualization support, for broadcast, for powering down regions, and for the reconfiguration. So this is what we can attain with this logic. Okay, this is the baseline for now on. So let's try to map partitions inside the chip. Okay? Let's imagine we have 2 failed areas and 3 applications that want these kind of resources. We need a hypervisor that will allocate the resources. Okay? How we can guarantee that will not be any traffic getting out? With the connectivity bit. The connectivity bits can be set to 1 or 0 in order to prevent the packets to get out. So here I have a topology. And here I have another topology. I disabled this link logically by setting the bit to 0. That's all. Okay? But maybe we need to overlap resources, overlap partitions. In which case, imagine that here we have the memory controller, and the memory controller needs to be accessed by this application and this application. We need to overlap, right? In order to allow all the traffic to reach the memory controller. How we can do this? We can extend the connectivity bits to a vector of connectivity bits. And then we have what we call the partitions, or no, regions. Region 0, this is the same region 0, but this is region 1. So here we have 2 different regions, IDs, okay? And then we can extend the routing bit, the LBDR, with a MUX. And then with the header, including the region identifier, we can select the proper connectivity bit, okay? This can be done, okay? But we are now implementing these kind of things on FPGAs, and the recommendation or the suggestion we have is it's better to have the memory control traffic separated. We can design 2 networks. One from traffic between L1s and L2s in per partition traffic, and one global to access shared resources that could be the memory controller. Okay? But LBDR can be extended to provide that. So at the end it's easy to have partitions, okay? But let's think on the following situation. What we want is a dynamic system where we have applications coming and applications getting out, right? We need the system to evolve. This is the chip multiprocessor, and then imagine that suddenly here we have a failure. This switch or this tile fails. Or these applications finishes and then there is a new one. Or this one wants to increase in size, okay? What we can do? Well, we need to reconfigure, okay? This is called reconfiguration. Notice that if the arrows do not change in position, reconfiguration is safe. There is no potential deadlock. But if I move or I remove restrictions like this one because failed, then I can have a deadlock. If you remove one restriction, you can have cycles, okay? So this is, we are entering the danger area, okay? If we want to reconfigure the system on the fly without stopping traffic, then we need to be very careful, okay? We have two options. The safest one is static. Before changing the configuration, I drain the system of traffic, I reconfigure, and then I resume, which is the impact that there is no service time, okay? There is reconfiguring. So this is the more conservative method, okay? Dynamic is more interesting, at least for the research community. Try to get it on the fly and then deadlock free, okay? This is dynamic. This is very complex because you can end up having this deadlock configuration. And then what we propose is a mixed approach. Let's do it static, but not at the network level, but at the port level. Only at the port level. Okay? So the ports will be static. We'll drain packets and then we'll reconfigure. Okay? But we'll be here and there. We'll be at the end dynamic, at the microscopic level. Notice, I have a configuration A here. This is deadlock free. You cannot find any cycle. Here is configuration B. This is acyclic also. But if I allow switches to evolve, okay, dynamically, these two switches reconfigure and means that this restriction has been removed, okay? And this one also, okay? And then notice that here I have a deadlock. Or here. Here I have another cycle, okay? So we need to prevent this. Which is the key? Notice that now I have new messages and old messages. What is old messages? The ones that are in configuration A, okay? And what is new messages? The one that is in configuration B, okay? I have a deadlock only if there are packets behind new messages, old messages, sorry, and old messages behind new messages. If there are old messages waiting for new messages to exit, then I have a cycle. If I prevent all messages to follow behind new messages, this is acyclic. Why? Because I'm pushing the old messages to drain and I'm reconfiguring. I don't allow any old message to go behind a new message. Okay? This is the key observation. If I guarantee this, then deadlock free and dynamic. Okay? But then the question is how you can guarantee in these complex systems that all messages will never go behind new messages. Then we define a token, okay? And the token will be a barrier. When you start reconfiguring, you trigger the barrier, and then the barrier is pushing the old messages to drain. And behind the token, you start to inject new messages. So, in the meantime, you can have half the network with new messages and the other half with old messages, okay? So this is the guy, this is the token that prevents all messages from advancing new messages. Okay? For this, we need a global view, always. Okay? For instance, imagine you have a failure. I have a failure here, and then this switch detects that there is a failure. Okay? And then this switch needs to notify the central manager that there has been a failure in order to trigger a reconfiguration, okay? So we need a dual network that is a skein chain. We need a very few traffic here only to notify this. And then the central manager, what performs is a fast computation of the new configuration, okay? Then spreads the new configuration bits, the LBDR bits, okay? And then triggers the tokens. The tokens are triggered. And the tokens will separate new old messages that are the current ones from new messages that are the ones that are being injected, okay? And all this is performed through this control network, okay? Notice that every switch now requires two LBDR sets for the old and the new, because in a switch, output ports are in old and output ports are in new, okay? Here you can see how the token propagates. Imagine this configuration. These are unidirectional arrows, links, and this is the unidirectional links also. Notice that here, the local port evolves to token 1, to epoch 1, in the advent of a reconfiguration, because the injectors can just inject new packets. Okay? They don't have old packets. Okay? And notice that this output port is in epoch 0. We need to drain this output port from old packets, okay? Because this restriction is there, we know that there will be no packets from the north to the west, okay? So this output port has been drained. There will be no packets. So what means this? That the epoch can go to this one and propagate. And then we send the token to the next switch, okay? So here we start the token propagation, and then here when drained, and this is the evolution of the token, and then it follows. These numbers are the cycle time when the token arrives to the switches. This means that in 47 cycles, if the network is empty, the network has been reconfigured in a safe mode. Okay? We have prevented old packets going behind new packets. Let me skip these details. And then let's see the results here. Here in red, you have the performance, the latency, average packet latency of messages in a 4-frame 2D mesh. Okay, this one. In green, you have the performance, the latency, when you have one failure from beginning. Okay? And here you have when suddenly a failure occurs, and then we trigger a static reconfiguration. Notice that the average latency goes very sharp to almost 500 cycles. Why? Because the packets are waiting in the queues, in the injection queues, while we are draining the network, okay? And then recovers, but the recovery time is very large, okay? Because we have a lot of contention. And here you have the reconfiguration strategy we have. Notice that here we have an impact, but we are very close to the desired latency with one failure, okay? Notice here we have temporal blocking, added temporal blocking. Why? Because a new packet can reach a switch and needs to wait for a token because it reaches the old part, okay? Simply because of that, okay? But let's try to be smarter. Let's try to bypass the token. What means bypassing the token? A new message arrives to the token and then crosses the token. This is dangerous, right? Because you can have a cycle, okay? But what if when you cross the token, you become old? What is becoming old? Is that you follow the old routing function, okay? Then this is deadlock-free, okay? So in the sense, here I have a switch, and notice the epochs. This is the old routing function, and this is the new routing function, okay? This input port is in epoch 1, okay? In LBDR, in the new, I request this output port that is old still. I need to wait for the token to advance, okay? Because here, there could be old packets crossing, okay? And the old routing function is still in epoch 0 also, okay? What I can do, I can either wait to the advance of the token and then go following the token, or I can take the old path and for that moment using the old routing function. This will be an old packet that before was new, but now it's an old, it's not a new. Okay? This is deadlock free. So this contention is this one, this small one. So if we remove this contention, and then we take that one, we get the following. This is the old, the reconfiguration we got. Notice that we can have maximum latency. Maximum latency is the packet with the maximum latency during the reconfiguration, okay? Not the average latency, okay? See in yellow. In yellow is if we bypass the token and become old, okay? Notice that here we trigger reconfiguration and the maximum latency of all the packets is the same. This means that there is no effect in latency. We have what we call a transparent reconfiguration, in the sense that we can trigger reconfiguration and the packets will not get blocked, will not get an extended latency. So this is a transparent reconfiguration. And even we can have very long reconfiguration times because the reconfiguration does not affect the performance. Okay? And this means that we can change the topology, the routing, or whatever we want, because at the end we change the routing. That is the smart part. Okay? So we can have a system that can adapt to our desired configuration without affecting performance. Okay? So let's think that we have a good routing strategy, and then we can have a reconfiguration strategy in order to configure all this. Okay? So now we have the means in order to have a good product, okay? But let's focus on coherence protocols, okay? So our belief is that an optimized NOC and coherence protocol may not require a photonic NOC. So in computer architecture, we are stressed because a photonic NOC tends to simplify the network, right? If you have a lot of bandwidth and it's very power efficient, okay? Then you don't need these kind of fancy things. But if you design the NOC, the electronic NOC, the best NOC for your system, then probably you don't require so much bandwidth. You can do very nice things, okay? So let's try to avoid. This was the, these guys are the electronic guys and the photonic guys are coming, okay? We try to avoid this, okay? So let's think, go fast, because I think we have 10 minutes, no much more. Okay, let's go first in the catch coherence protocols. Okay, I will go very, very brief. This is the typical directory-based MOSI protocol. Okay, basically what you need to guarantee is that the L2, you know where the copies are in L1s. Okay, in order to keep the coherence. Okay, this is the basic idea. Okay, so this is very the automatas of the MOSI protocol, and then let's think in the following. Let me go. This is a directory-based protocol, and this is a broadcast-based protocol. A directory-based protocol, when there is a processor, an L1, that wants a block, then triggers a request to the L2, okay? And the L2 has a directory and knows that these two L1s have a copy. Sends an invalidation message to these two in order to invalidate. And they send an acknowledgement to the requester, okay? And this processor that is requesting a write waits all this time until it writes in the block, okay? If we have a broadcast-based protocol, you don't have any directory. You only know if there is a copy in the chip or not, but you don't know who has a copy. This means that when there is a request to write a block to L2, the L2 needs to invalidate all the copies in the cache, in the chip. Okay? And it means that needs to send invalidations to all the devices, to all the resources. And they need to send an acknowledgement to the requester. Okay? So we have two things. We need multicast and broadcast, okay, to be efficient. And the most important, we need a gather operation. We need to be efficient in gathering information. If this is unicast messages from different sources to the same destination, we have a serialization effect. If we have 256 acknowledgments being received by the same node, we have a lot of latency. Okay? We need to gather on the fly in the network. Okay? There is potential for broadcast-based? Yes. Here you see the percentage of broadcast, gather, and unicast messages. Broadcast and gather network, gather messages represent 60% of all the traffic in a broadcast system. Okay? So, in an acknowledgement, the thing is, acknowledgement is just a synchronization event. It's just telling you, okay, and you send it to the requester, and the requester is waiting for you. So why you need to use a knock in order to send that? This is not efficient. You use 32 bits just to trigger one bit. This is not efficient, okay? So let's use just one bit to notify with an acknowledgement to the destination, to the requester, okay? But let's go in that direction because maybe this is not practical, okay? So what we propose is the following. Let's try to have a tree of AND gates for every destination. So whenever I send a broadcast, all the nodes reply just triggering one bit of an additional knock. It's a tree of AND gates, okay? These AND gates will ramificate, no? And then at the end, you will get one single bit, not 16 bits, one single bit. It will tell you that all acknowledged your request, okay? This is a combinational logic. We want a sequential logic, okay? So we evolve this to this. This is the typical switch we can find in networks on chip. Typical buffers, crossbar, arbiters. Let's add this. This is not 50% of the area. This is just 15% of the area. Okay? What we call this is a network of IDs. Okay? We have 5 ports also, 2D mesh. Okay? And here we have input logic, an AND matrix. Notice that this is not a crossbar. An output logic. And then we have wiring shuffling. Okay? What is this? The AND matrix is simply collecting, gathering acknowledgements from different nodes. Okay, to the same node, to the other node, to the other node. We have an AND matrix, okay? And we have IDs. Instead of one bit, we have IDs. I want to acknowledge tile number 12. So I trigger through this network number 12. And then when you have number 12 from these two input ports, they will condense in one AND matrix, and the ID 12 will go out, one single ID, through the output port, towards tile number 12. Okay? So notice that here you don't have here you have buffering, okay, because you can have contention, okay? But the buffering is the following. When you receive an ID, you just allocate one bit, the acknowledgement. Okay? You only need one bit. Okay? The AND gate is this one. It's wiring. Just collecting the bits from the same ID, okay? And then go to the output logic, okay? And then in the output logic, you have a priority encoder because you can have contention of different IDs going through the same output port, and then you send one and then after the other, okay? So, with all this, we have these results. Notice that this is the average. The first one is the Hammer protocol. Hammer protocol is a broadcast-based protocol without broadcast and without the network of IDs, okay? Without gathering, okay? You have performance of one. The second bar is the Hammer protocol with the broadcast support. They send a broadcast packet, one single packet on broadcast. But I don't have the gather network or the network of IDs. I get a reduction of 4 or 5%, okay? The blue one is the Hammer with the gather, with the broadcast protocol and the network of IDs, collecting the ACKs, the acknowledgements, okay? Notice that we have good reduction, okay? And then the red one is the most interesting one. This is a directory-based protocol. The performance is better than the Hammer protocol because when you send invalidations, you just send 2 or 3 invalidations, not all, okay? But notice that with optimizations, the Hammer protocol behaves better than the directory-based protocol without requiring directories, and directories do not scale also, okay? So we can remove the directory and behave better than the directory-based protocol, okay? And here you can see the benefit in the reduction of number of messages sent through the normal knock, okay? We remove only 60% of the traffic. with the saving in power that this have. Okay? Okay. Do I have 10 minutes more? It's okay. Just introducing one concept. Okay. So, then we have, and this will be the last topic, we have a good routing strategy. We can partition, we can reconfigure, okay? And we have a network of IDs, okay? That allows us to be efficient, okay? What's next? Or what could be the best thing? Notice here. Here we have the performance, no, the average distance between L2s and L1s. The L2 is the home, and L1s are the shares, okay? Notice here that this is for a static NUCA. Static means that your home is statically allocated. Depending on your address, is in tile 15, for instance. It's very far. Okay? So things are far, okay, from the chip, from the requester. Okay? DNUCA is a dynamic NUCA. Dynamic means that the block is allocated close to your shares, but not very close, okay, because define bank sets and cannot get out of bank sets. Okay? And this is what we would like to have, private L2s. Okay, what is private L2? When you have a miss in L1, you fetch in your local L2, okay? And then you have a miss, the block will go to your local L2. It's a private cache. But you cannot have many memory because you only can have L2. So applications can overrun this cache. But distance is very close, almost to one hop distance. What we would like to have, this one. We get things closer, will be better, right? So why not? When we have a miss in L1, why don't we fetch in L2? And if there is a miss, then we go to the memory controller, that is typical, right? And then the memory controller decides where to allocate the L2, okay? Probably we'll put it in your local L2. This doesn't mean that it's private, it's shared, but it puts closer to the requester, okay? We have only one problem. Then when I have a miss in L1 and L2, I need to fetch if there is in cache or not, in the chip or not, right? This is the problem I have, okay? But as I said before, we have a broadcast operation, okay? So we propose the following protocol. It's coherence protocol, but with an underlying network on chip. This is the runtime home mapping protocol. I fetch in L1, there is a miss, I fetch in L2, local tile to the tile, okay? If there is a hit, perfect, okay? If there is a miss, I send a home search. I try to see, hey, there is an EL2 that has this block, okay? And then we perform a broadcast, okay? We fetch all the L2s. And the L2s reply with the gather network, okay? And in the gather network, we allocated one extra bit. This is a hit. If this bit is set to 1, it means that one of the L2s have the block. And it's sending to you a copy, one copy. Okay? If the hit signal through the acknowledgement, the gather network, is 0, it means that the block is not on chip. Then you go to the memory controller, and the memory controller, while waiting to fetch the block from memory, decides which will be the home for this block, which is the best option to put it in the requester. If the requester is full, you can put it in the neighbor. Try to get closer. If now there is another one that needs to do this, then we can migrate or we can replicate. Okay? This adds complexity to the cache coherence protocol. But the good thing is that having the gather network speed ups the fetch of the block inside the chip. Okay? So, basically, we can have here the results. This is for hop distance. We reduce the distance from L1s to L2s because the memory controller puts very close to the requesters. Okay? And here in execution time, we also save a lot. We have different versions with migration and replication support, only with migrations, without migration and replication support, and with directories, as without directories. Okay? And the final thing is, okay, I can get things closer to my requesters. Can I do this at the partition level? Of course. If I have a memory controller and then I have three applications, I can enhance the memory controller to be aware of the partitions, and then to allocate the blocks to L2s inside the partition. And this means that the traffic will never get out of the partition, because the memory controller is putting your resources, your data inside your resources. Okay? But when I fetch for a block, I need to constrain to a partition. Okay? And this is just one wire. And then we will conclude with this. Here you have the LBDR for the south port. Remember, connectivity bit tells you if there is connectivity or not. This should be a south. Okay? This is a typo. And this is the network of IDs. Okay? If this bit is set to zero, what means? That here I have the partition border. Okay? Should I expect acknowledgments from these tiles? No. Then it means that this is negated, and then just tells you that all these IDs has been received by default. So by combining these two logics with one simple wire, we can generate the IDs in the borders in order not to wait infinitely for other IDs, for other partitions. Okay? And this gives us also potential to define processor partitions and home partitions. What if one application requires 16 cores and 20 L2s? Then I need more memory than processors. Then I can define this partition, 16 cores, 20 L2s, okay? And the LBDR can allow this, because we define two borders with the connectivity bits, okay? And this goes to the final thing. This is what we call the partition knock and coherence protocol. And we get, here we are running four applications in four domains, symmetric domains, okay? And then we got the same performance of first touch. First touch is an operating-based protocol, okay? It means that it goes perfectly. Static NUCA, because you are mixing all the blocks in all the tiles, then you get very bad performance. Here we have an heterogeneous configuration. This application requires more memory, okay? And here you can steal, you can notice, this is what we call stealing memory from other tiles. You can see that you have an impact on execution time, okay, for this test. Okay? So as a conclusion, we have a routing strategy, the compact. We can reconfigure the system without impact on performance. And we enhance the coherence protocol in order to be partitioned oriented. Okay? What's missing here is who is going to deal with all this. Okay? Who is going to deal with this configuration capability? Okay? And this is what we call the hypervisor in the operating system that should be aware of this potential and then knows all the requests and then can configure this. This is a software. Okay? And then this is ongoing work. We are concluding this, and then we need to develop the hypervisor to be efficient. And that's all. So, thank you very much. The thing is that for us the L2 is the last shared cache, last level cache, that is shared among all the tiles, all the processors, then you can never have a copy of the block in two L2s. You will have only one. You need to decide which is the home, the L2 home for this block, and should be there only, one single copy. You can have two copies in L1s, because they are private. Okay? In this case, if one processor wants to write in this one, because it's in shared mode, needs to notify the L2 and DL2 needs to invalidate that one before allowing this to write. You need to keep coherence. So we need, this is the protocol. The protocol does not allow to have different values in the same block, in different caches. So this is what adds a lot of complexity in the protocol. This is the simplified view of the finite state machine of the messy protocol in L1s and in L2s. In L1s, if when you want to write it, if you have a modified state, you can write it because it's guaranteed that there will be no copy in the cache, in the chip. Okay? But it's in shared mode. It means that you have a copy and another one has a copy. So you want to write it, you perform a git get x. It means that I want to get exclusiveness to this block. Okay? And this is if I receive it. If I want to write it, okay, if I want to write it, I perform a store operation and then should go to modify it. But before, you need to get an exclusive mode from shared to private. So before doing this, you send a message to L2 and the L2 needs to migrate to this state. In order to migrate to this state, needs to invalidate the other copy. And then once you are here, you have exclusiveness to your copy. Okay? And then you avoid this situation. This is the simplified view. In reality, the automata is 5 times more complex because you have many race conditions, because you have multiple requests coming. If you are migrating from this to this, what happens if now you get another request in the meantime? So there are many, many race conditions, and the protocol evolves and it's very complex. Which is the scalability of the knock.
Exactly. For instance, if I get 2 and 3, I can say that my application goes 2 and 3 times faster, or more or less, what is the prediction?
As always, you can face scalability by exploiting locality. If you use a static NUCA and then you increase your system from 8 to 8 to 16 to 16, your L2 will be much more far away, right? And then you have a penalty, and the knock is becoming the bottleneck. But you, in this approach, you cannot do anything else. You can change the topology and then have some express channels and all these kind of things, but this adds complexity and delay. If you try to exploit locality, like the runtime home mapping, if you try to get things closer to the requestors, then the network behaves as a local device. Do you try to exploit traffic that a maximum will be 2 hops, 3 hops? Of course, when you have the first miss of a block, you need to go to the memory container, maybe it's too far away. But if you get things closer, you can face the scalability. If we go for 10K nodes, then I don't know if this becomes again a bottleneck, but I don't think that we will get these kind of systems also. And the other thing is that we get hierarchy. I don't think that we will have a planar 2D mesh for large systems. What we will have is an increased complexity in the tile, and then the 2D mesh will be remaining the same. So we have two networks, for instance, one inside the tile and the other among tiles. But I don't expect to have more than 256 tiles. So it's one way to exploit locality with the internal crossbar or the ring or whatever. And then if you partition also, you can also get locality in the partitions. And the problem also is to test the scalability with the current simulators. Evaluating these kind of systems for more than 64 cores is very time consuming. And these applications take 1 weekend for running to get the results for this kind of system, for 4x4 mesh. Questions? More questions? No?
How do you simulate it? Is you make it in an FPGA?
up to now we use always cycle accurate event driven simulators, homemade. We connected to graphite, to Gen 5, and all this kind of, or snipper, this kind of system level simulators that allows you to run. We also use traces collected from a snipper or from graphite. Okay. At the end, you get a compromise. Okay. Now we are facing implementing all this inside an FPGA. So the current status is that we right now we have designed a processor, very small processor, like a MIPS processor. Three networks, one global network, and the other two is for the protocols, for the coherence protocols, with LBDR, with the reconfiguration stuff also, with broadcast and with the network of IDs. And the runtime home mapping and the static directory is also implemented. We have the L1s and the L2s. We are now facing, we have all the code in Verilog, and now we are facing putting together inside the FPGA. A simulation level works. But you know that when you go to the FPGA, new situations happen, right? Now we are facing that one. We expect to get this. Without the coherence protocol, we managed to do this inside an FPGA, putting 16 microblazes and one network with all this reconfiguration capability in a demonstrator for an European project. And it worked very fine. So it was the proof that works. Not only in simulator, that you know that you can demonstrate everything in simulators. Here it worked. Okay. That's all? I think the limit is power. The people saying about dark silicon area, that you cannot manage to have all the transistors running at the same time, and then you need to switch off, and then you map one application in one corner of the chip, then it becomes very hot, and then you move it, and then you try to avoid this kind of hot spots. This will be the limiting factor, probably. Now there is one company that is called Calray, this European company, and they sell chips with 256 cores. They are very long instruction word processors. They do clustering. They have 16 processors in each cluster, and they have 16 clusters. They have a 2D torus, and then the next will be a 2D mesh. They reach 256. I think the industry can reach more, much more, but you need to be power efficient, so this could be... And we need to wait also if photonics came in also, if they are viable or not. But I attended one conference with Pradeep Bose from IBM, and we were saying that putting more than, he was saying even 64, will not be power efficient. He had his analysis and said, industry probably can go for many cores, but it's not power efficient. So then will you go for the dark silicon and all this? Who knows?